So, which are you? Human, or an artificial brain enjoying a fictional life?
Beep boop, son. Beep boop.
Which paradox just mindfucks a person?
Bray's paradox. From Wiki, the observation that adding one or more roads to a road network can end up impeding overall traffic flow through it. The paradox was postulated in 1968 by German mathematician Dietrich Brace, who noticed that adding a road to a particular congested road traffic network would increase overall journey time.
That's really weird. Why is that the case? Does reducing the number of roads allow traffic to flow faster?
The rest of the replies did not look at the paradox. The answer is that the new path may be a new shortcut, and so many cars use the new shortcut that were once on a main road that they change the flow overall. For example, a crucial intersection along the shortcut would have significantly increased traffic, which would affect other roads in unplanned ways.
So I know this is just a silly thing, but at my old work, my department was food service. In our prep room, you had to always wear an apron. Always, no exceptions. When leaving the prep room, you had to take your apron off to prevent cross-contamination. The bosses were trying to figure out where to put the hooks. Inside in the back of the door, or outside on the wall.
That this page is intentionally left blank page. The page isn't even blank anymore. I actually saw one in a textbook before that said this page intentionally no longer blank.
I like this. The reasoning that goes behind those pages is actually really neat. Books are printed and bound in signatures, a way of imposing pages of content. They always come in fours. So if your book has 199 pages of content, it'll be in 50 signatures. That means one page has to be left blank. This is something I deal with fairly often, producing short-run marketing booklets and brochures. I'll have someone give me 13 pages of content. I then tell them they either need to cut one page of content or add three more.
The UK triple lock that people moving to the UK experience. Need proof of address and photographic ID to open a bank account. Need a bank account and photographic ID to rent a place. Need a bank account and an address to get sent your photographic ID. Checkmate atheists.
This is like when I went online to schedule an appointment at the Apple Store because my phone wouldn't turn on and they sent me a verification text to my phone to confirm it was me, telling them that my phone won't turn on.
One of my favorites is Zeno's paradox. In order to leave my apartment, just for example, I have to walk halfway to my front door. Then I have to walk half the remaining distance. Then half that distance, ad infinitum. In theory, I should never be able to reach the door. Now I love this paradox, because we've actually solved it. It was a lively, well-discussed debate for millennia. At least a few early thinkers were convinced that motion was an illusion because of it. It was so persuasive an argument that people doubted their senses. Then Leibniz and/or Newton developed calculus, and we realized that infinite sums can have finite solutions. Paradox resolved. It makes me wonder what calculus we are missing to resolve some of these others.
The ship of Theseus always kind of fucked me. So, there's this Greek dude called Theseus, and he's on a very long boat trip home. His ship needs repair. They stop, replace a few rotten boards, and continue. Due to the particularly strenuous nature of this very long trip, several more of these stops for repairs are made, until, by the very end, not a single board from the original vessel remains. Is this still the same vessel? If not, when did it cease to be?
Douglas Adams once shared an anecdote of this concept in practice. I remembered once, in Japan, having been to see the Gold Pavilion Temple in Kyoto and being mildly surprised at quite how well it had weathered the passage of time since it was first built in the 14th century. I was told it hadn't weathered well at all, and had in fact been burned to the ground twice in this century. So it isn't the original building. I had asked my Japanese guide. But yes, of course it is, he insisted, rather surprised at my question. But it's burned down. Yes. Twice. Many times. And rebuilt. Of course. It is an important and historic building. With completely new materials. But of course. It was burned down. So how can it be the same building? It is always the same building. I had to admit to myself that this was in fact a perfectly rational point of view. It merely started from an unexpected premise. The idea of the building, the intention of it, its design, are all immutable and are the essence of the building. The intention of the original builders is what survives. The wood of which the design is constructed decays and is replaced when necessary. To be overly concerned with the original materials, which are merely sentimental souvenirs of the past, is to fail to see the living building itself. For me, it's a very interesting example of how different cultures interpret the idea of continuity. For example, there is a shrine complex in Japan called Ai's Shrine, which is the most sacred locations in Shinto. Every 20 years, the two main buildings are dismantled and rebuilt, by hand, by hundreds of volunteers. This ritual is based on the idea of impermanence, death and renewal in Shinto, but it's also done to keep the skills of constructing the shrine alive throughout the generations. The same is done in many shrines and temples throughout the country. This is interesting to me because you could argue that the cycle of destruction and renewal with new materials is precisely what gives it its continuity.
The Boltzmann brain. The idea goes something like this. In any system, there is a tendency for entropy to increase, which is another way of saying that everything tends to spread out. In a room full of gas, the gas fills the room, it does not pack itself in a corner. However, because of the weirdness of quantum fluctuations, it is possible for particles to just spontaneously arrange themselves into more complex configurations. It might take trillions and trillions of years, but if you watched that room full of gas long enough, sooner or later you would see all of the gas pack itself into one corner before spreading out again. Or, you might see the gas arrange itself into a fully functioning human brain. Complete with false memories, senses, and a brief spark of consciousness. Of course, entropy would quickly take over again, the brain would dissolve back into gas almost immediately. This is also hideously unlikely. But over an infinite time, the laws of physics tell us this is not just likely. It is inevitable. So which are you? Human? Or Boltzmann brain enjoying the briefest moment of your fictional life before you dissolve back into space dust?
Newcomb's paradox. There are two boxes, A and B. A contains either $1,000 or $0 and B contains $100. Box A is opaque, so you can't see inside. Box B is clear, so you can see for sure that there is $100 in it. Your options is to choose both boxes, or to choose only box A. There is an entity called the predictor, which determines whether or not the $1,000 will be in box A. How he chooses this is by predicting whether or not you will choose both boxes, or just box A. If the predictor predicts that you will, two box, he will leave box A empty. If he predicts that you will, one box, he will put the $1,000 in box A. He is accurate, an overwhelming amount of the time, but not 100%. At the time of your decision, the contents of box A, i.e. whether or not there is anything in it, are fixed, and nothing you do at that point will change whether or not there is anything in the box. It is a paradox of decision theory that rests on two principles of rational choice. According to the principle of strategic dominance, there are only two possibilities, and you don't know which one holds. Box A is empty, therefore you should choose both boxes, to get $100 as opposed to $0. Box A is full, therefore you should choose both boxes, to get $1,100 as opposed to just $1,000. Therefore, you should always choose both boxes, since under every possible scenario, this results in more money. But, according to the principle of expected value, choosing one box is superior because you have a statistically higher chance of getting more money. Most of the people who have gone before you who have chosen one box have gotten $1,000, and most that have chosen both boxes have gotten only $100. Therefore, if you analyze the problem statistically, or in terms of which decision has the higher probability of resulting in a higher outcome, you should choose only one box. Imagine 1 billion people going before you, and you actually seeing so many of them have this outcome. Any outliers became insignificant. In terms of strategic dominance, two boxing is always superior to one boxing because no matter what is in box A, two boxing results in more money. One boxing, on the other hand, has a demonstrably higher probability of resulting in a larger amount of money. Both of these choices represent fundamental principles of rational choice. There are two rival theories, causal decision theory, which supports strategic dominance, and evidential decision theory, which supports expected utility. It is pretty arcane but one of the most difficult paradoxes in contemporary philosophy. Robert Nozick summed it up well, to almost everyone, it is perfectly clear and obvious what should be done. The difficulty is that these people seem to divide almost evenly on the problem, with large numbers thinking that the opposing half is just being silly.
The infinite hotel one is not exactly a paradox, but still a mindfuck. A hotel has an infinite number of rooms and can accommodate an infinite number of guests, one per room. A traveler walks up to the front desk and inquires about a room. Sadly, it's infinity day and an infinite number of people are in town celebrating, so every one of the rooms is full. However, the clever desk clerk realizes he can still fit the traveler in by asking everyone to move into the room number that's one higher than theirs. So the person in room 1 moves to room 2, room 2 moves to room 3, etc. Now room 1 is free for the traveler. However, just as the traveler has been accommodated, an infinite busload of people arrives looking for rooms. The hotel is surely full now, right? Nope. The clerk realizes he can ask everyone to move into a room that's twice the room number of their own. So room 1 moves to room 2, room 2 moves to room 4, room 3 moves to room 6, etc. Now all the odd-numbered rooms are empty and can be filled with the new guests. So in a sense, an infinitely full hotel is still infinitely empty.
Psychology. Psychology is defined as the study of the human brain. That would mean that the human brain is teaching, studying, and learning from itself all at the same time. In a sense, the brain is the teacher, the textbook, and the student at the same time.
If the brain were so simple we could fully understand it, we'd be so simple that we couldn't.
The bootleg paradox, the main example is Beethoven, so I'll use him. If you were to go back in time, you would see Beethoven, but when you get there, you cannot find Beethoven anywhere, but you have all of his music sheets. So you create all of Beethoven's music, so technically, you are Beethoven. Now the real question is, where did the music come from, and how did the name Beethoven come to be? Not a paradox, but a mindfuck. Imagine a drop of water forming at the tip of a leaf in the Amazon jungle, high up in a tree. That drop is teeming with life, right? Microscopic life forms, interacting with each other, living their life, right? Kinda as if it was a tiny world, or a tiny universe in there. The life forms in there more than probably have no idea they are in a water droplet, they have no idea there's a whole world beyond it. They're so fucking tiny, how could they know? I mean, we don't know what lies beyond our observable universe, do we? That drop falls towards the floor. And during its fall, life in there keeps thriving and keeps going on, and then the drop hits the floor, a hot stone, and evaporates. Poof goes that entire micro world. Gone, in the blink of an eye. And not a single life form in that drop could do anything to prevent it. I mean, even if there was intelligent life in it, it simply might not have had the means to discover what lies beyond their observable universe, the water droplet. They had no idea they were in a droplet, falling to their inevitable doom. For them, the time it takes for the droplet to form and fall down might feel like an eternity, even if for us it's really short. After all, humanity feels like an eternity for us, but on a historical scale, we've existed for a ridiculously short amount of time. Entire civilizations might have existed in there while the droplet was forming and falling. Imagine that our observable universe is the water droplet and we are the life forms teeming inside it. For all we know, our universe might currently forming on a leaf or even falling already, and at some point we'll hit the floor and we'll be gone, just like that. Nobody will give a fuck, just like we don't give a fuck about that tiny universe in the water droplet that just disappeared. We might be one of the many universes that disappears like this, just like that water droplet is one of the many. And not a single person could have known or prevented this.
If you asked Rick Astley for his copy of Disney Pixar's Up, do you think he'd give it to you? Because think about it. He's never gonna give you up. But at the same time, if he doesn't give you up, then he's let you down. But he's never gonna let you down. So which is it?
My absolute favorite is the free will paradox. Dot. If God exists as is stated in the Bible, then he is omnipotent, all-powerful, has the ability to do literally anything one could conceive of. Omnipresent. Is everywhere at once at all times within all of time. Omniscient. Knows literally everything. The complete summation of all knowledge that has existed, currently exists, or will exist. The Bible also states that God gave man free will, the ability to believe what you want, do what you want, and be in control of your own life. We choose to believe in God or not believe in God. Be good, be evil, etc. Even in all God's power, he won't influence our choices directly. They are completely our own. The issue here is this. If God is omniscient and knows all things, then he knows our past, present, and future. He knows every tiny little detail about our lives, beginning to end. Even if there are multiple timelines, he knows every detail about alternate realities too. There is not one single fact unknown to God. If this is in fact the case, and God created all with full knowledge of everyone's entire life, then free will cannot exist, as our future is known and predetermined. If not, then God is not omniscient and is an imperfect and flawed being capable of failures and mistakes. Either God gave us free will, or he is omniscient, but it cannot be both.